Hi, my name is Benny Vanecek, and this is my wife, Machelle. And we've been married 48 years. And how that happened, heck if I know. Will it go on? I hope so. Forever. So, I guess I'd start off, and then Machelle can jump in. We were both going to Texas Western College, which is now the University of Texas, El Paso. And Machelle and I were taking the same Spanish course. I didn't know who she was, but I knew she was pretty good looking. And I had a buddy that knew her, and he introduced us. You can take it a little bit from there.
Well, things just kind of started clicking from there. We used to meet at this place called the Coffee House down by UTEP, and we'd go down there after our Spanish class. We had Spanish class together every day of the week. And after we got through with Spanish, we would go down to the coffee house and have coffee. And things just kind of progressed from there. I didn't have a job at the time. I was going to school. He did have a job. He was working at Providence Hospital as an orderly. So our evenings were slim to none, to say the least, because he worked until 11 o'clock at night. At that time, I was living in the dorm, and I had to be in, so the smooch time didn't really happen too often. But I helped him get through. He was graduating that year, and I helped him with a correspondence class, yeah, in Kitty Litt. So when I didn't have anything to do, I was doing Kitty Litt classes for him and mailing them in to help him get through with school. And we finally decided, yes, we did want to get married. And I just said, let's go ahead, let's get married. No, we're not going to get married now. I have to graduate. So I let him graduate, and I think 3 days later we got married. There was one thing that my grandmother told me growing up. She always said that a marriage needs to be of one religion. And at the time, I was a Protestant. But remembering what my grandmother had said, I agreed to go through and take Catholic instructions, which I did. I went 2 to 3 times a week for 3 hours every night and took instructions. And then I was confirmed and baptized, and then we were married in the church.
And it wasn't 2 or 3 days after I graduated. It was a couple of weeks. But that's not all that happened. 2 weeks, we got married. The third week, I started with Shell Oil Company, a really fine job that I had, my first one. And the next week, I got drafted by the Army to go to Vietnam. Well, I won't say thankfully I flunked the physical, but I worked so hard to get through school, working night and day and no money. I just wanted to put Uncle Sam off for a while if I could, but I did flunk the physical because I had a problem with one of my legs. I had a wreck years ago, and it was bothering me. So anyway, they let me out. And I did have a real fine job, and the first year or so that I had this job, I traveled like crazy, gone every week. And I would only come home like on Monday and Tuesday, gone again through the weekend. That put a real strain on our marriage, and to the point of where I said, I think I'm going to quit. And I said, Michelle, I'll go to work for somebody, but I won't work for Michelle anymore. I'll stay home. I said, we're not going to get anywhere. That's okay too, maybe. We'll stay home. And she kind of compromised and said, well was good enough for me, because then I really worked hard at it. And that ended too. The job didn't end, but the traveling ended for a while. And so all of a sudden, our life was about to change again. She says, Benny, I think I'm pregnant. Well, I was overjoyed. It was a thrill to me and to her. And with life comes tragedy, and we lost that baby. Just wasn't meant to be. And then, probably a year and a half later, Mm-hmm. Here comes a bouncing baby blonde-haired girl. Really brought joy to our life. And she now is 46 years old, I think. Mm-hmm. The mother of three beautiful grandchildren, and one of her children has a baby too, so we're great-grandparents. And you might tell them about the kids.
There's two girls and one boy. Hunter is 13, Allison is soon to be 18, and Katie's 20. Beautiful children. They're the most precious thing you could ever want in your life, along with a great grandbaby. And hopefully we'll get to see her next month. They live in Oklahoma. 2 years later, we had another child. We had moved around. We were in New Orleans at that time. And Kimberly was born in New Orleans, what we called our little coon ass back then. And
that's a nickname for the people live in southern Louisiana.
Louisiana. And
can't believe you said that.
Yeah, well, whatever.
No, I'm just kidding.
Anyway, she was born there in Baptist Hospital. And to back up with Shannon, Shannon was born in El Paso, Texas at Hotel Dew, a Catholic hospital. But anyway, we had our two girls, and we moved around in Louisiana, and both of the girls went to Catholic school in Baton Rouge. And that's where our lives changed again. He was with Shell, and all of a sudden he had an opportunity to go to work for McDonald's. And he went to work for McDonald's. And we were there for 6 or 7 years and moved on with another opportunity to have our own McDonald's store in Odessa, Texas. And what a whirlwind that was. Even the girls had to go to work at such a young age. But, you know, through it all, it was good. We threw God into our lives with church. The girls were in Catholic school. And it was a beautiful time in our life. And then we were blessed in 1984 with an opportunity to come back to El Paso. And we moved back here and had our own McDonald's store here also.
One of the reasons we came back here too was because it was a great opportunity. And we bought multiple stores. But my mother also lived here. And God bless my mother, she was a saint. And my father died at a young age, and she was by herself. Of course, I had a sister and a brother there, but mother is mother, and there is not but one. And I feel no regrets that I didn't do enough for my mother or my father, because we did. And I often told Michelle I felt an obligation to her parents, too. And I don't have any regrets with her mother or father that I didn't do my best to do best for them. And I think that's important. But as you go through life, as we did, and still going, I think so, there's all sorts of challenges in your life. The one thing that, you know, they talk about causes marital problems is money and communication. Well, money was never our problem because we didn't have any. When we first got married, we had no money. So we couldn't argue over money because we just didn't have it. If you argue, you can't win. But Michelle was very, you know, she compromised. And I'm going to use that word a few more times after a while. She compromised, and, you know, that's all we could do. And I can remember when I first got the job with the oil company, we were really desperate for money. And they lost our paycheck. They sent it to some other place in the world but El Paso, Texas. So I can remember she went and borrowed money, and she even sold cases of Coke bottles to get some money together so we could live. The other one, the big one that I'll speak to, is communication. There must be effective communication for your marriage to work. You must express your feelings. If you bury your feelings, the problem is only going to fester, get worse. If it's about money, you need to speak to it. If it's about the way you treat one another, you need to speak to it. If you're drunk, you need to sober up. And she's told me that before. once or twice, I think, in 48 years, maybe more. But you must learn to communicate. Extremely important. Then there comes another chapter in your life. My little brother always referred to life as different chapters that you go through. And I really have to agree to that. That is that your daughters grow up and they get married. And we have to understand, Michelle and I had to understand that, you know, they didn't marry the kind of person we thought was great for them. They married what they wanted and not what we wanted. And we were wrong and they were right. And we spent quite a bit of money getting them married. But that's another chapter in your life, is when your children leave and they go with somebody else and they live their life. So we married one, then we married another one. And the second one, they both of them divorced. Both of them got a divorce and broke our hearts, but there's nothing we could do about it. We just accepted it. The best we could accept it. What does that mean? I don't really know. I can't tell you. But it's just, you can't change it. It is what it is. And the youngest one married a policeman. He's a sergeant on the police force. Still is. And he is kind of like our son that we never had. And then that causes problems with our baby daughter. She said, y'all like him more than you like me. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Well, those things happen, but we certainly do love the man, and I do a lot with him. We play a lot of golf, we travel, you know, and I think daughter's jealous of it, but, and then she really understands too, because Kimberly, he is the son we never had. So, I mean, that's another chapter. Both of them got divorces. And our grandchildren were affected by our oldest daughter's marriage. They fought quite a bit. He was doing some things he shouldn't have been doing. And the little girl, the oldest daughter, heard all that fussing and fighting, I guess as you say, going on. And we all went through some adjustment again. Here's some things we don't like at all. This is not what we wanted in our life. We wanted all our girls to be happily married, a house full of kids, so we could bring all the grandchildren home. Da da da. Well, don't work that way. It didn't work that way. So, you know, marriage is a vocation, as you said, but it's one, you know, you have to work at it. Work real hard. Each day can be a little bit of a challenge. You don't accept each day as it is, because each day is different. Different things come up. We just had a big function in our church, the diocese, and one of my daughters was sitting next to me, and I was bidding on an item, and I looked over, she was bidding on the same item, and it was my money. So, you know, you go through a lot of little things. Then it caused an argument with Michelle and I. Well, she hasn't really got over it just yet, but sooner or later she will. I hope. There is compromise that you do when you're married. You may not like what your spouse wants, but you know what? You give in and say, okay, let's go. And the next time it may be that I want to do something, she says, man, I don't want to do that. But she says, if you got to go to Rio Dosa, then we'll go. If that's what you want, then we're going to go. And man, I'm so happy to go. I love the place. And, you know, just another one of that's kind of a small thing, but you can get bigger and bigger in life with the compromising part. But so, be it as it may, Michelle, speak. Please.
I'm going to go back to 4 years ago when I became active in the ACTS community. And what a deal that is. It's the most refreshing, revitalizing thing in your life ever. And I've been associated with it for 4 years. Dearly loved it. And I had hopes of him going this last year. But he decided that he needed to get both of his knees done instead. So he got the knees done. And hopefully this year or next year, when he's in the right frame of mind, that he will choose to do that also. And they couples have said to me that it really brings a marriage together. I learned so much of give and take with the Axe community and being involved, and it really changed my life. 48 years have been great, really great. Our marriage was blessed this last Sunday in church, and I couldn't be happier with whom I'm with.
I would say the same.
But, you know, I'll agree with him. There are challenges every day, and a stepping stone every day also. But you learn from these steps that you take, where you grow, and your love for each other becomes a little more stronger, meaningful, and but you've always got to keep God in your life.
You know, I'm an early riser because I go to the gym most every day. And I get up, and before I turn the TV on, there's total silence. And sometimes when I'm at home by myself, she's out somewhere, there's silence. And I often think what it must be for people that have lost their spouse. It must be really a terrible, trying time. I had a dear friend of mine tell me he lost his spouse, and he said he couldn't stand the dark, the deafness, I guess. And he leaves the TV on all night long. If he wakes up, he hears noise. He goes to sleep with noise. Two of you become one. And when one leaves, I don't know how. I'm not prepared for that. And I don't ever want to be prepared for that. But it's not easy being married. It's very difficult. But there's nothing in the world that God gave than two people. And two people in love is better than just two people. You know, I understand some couples that they won't commit to getting married. I have a cousin that said, I'll never get married. He's now 55 years old, I think. I asked him, I said, your name is Nick. I said, Nicky, why are you, what is the deal? He said, all my friends are divorced. He said, I don't want to get involved. He said, I don't want the pain and misery I see him going through. And, you know, I'd say one thing to that, too. If you really think you love somebody, care for somebody at the young age, you got to go. You got to go. You just got to do it. And you got to trust and believe in God, along with your life, that it will work for you. And like I've always said, and you're on your road to wherever you're going, there's going to be some blocks there. There's some blockades. And you don't stop. You find a way to go around them. You go around them and continue on your journey. So I do understand that. And Machelle, how do you feel about that?
I agree with you. But I think if you can't make the commitment that this is really what you want to do, you shouldn't get involved in it. Everybody wants a happy marriage. And if you've got that fear or that concern that perhaps it's not going to work, you're entering into something right there that isn't going to work. You have to be positive about your attitude of what you want and how you're going to get to it. But if you start out with, I don't know if this is going to work, don't do it. You need to go back and think about it, pray about it, and put God first. And He will make those decisions or help you make those decisions in what the final outcome of your life will be. God is important because he sets the rules, and we abide by the rules. And he walks with us, and we walk with him with this. And I think that if you put him first, you will have a happy marriage. And again, I go back to my grandmother by saying, I was a convert. And she always spoke to the fact of, you can't have one religion here and another religion here, and then you take the kids here, you take them there. They're confused also. But as long as you come together with that one religion or one faith, then I feel that you will have a happy and enduring marriage.
Well, he's the big boy, okay? He made us all, and we should never forget that. And whenever you need help, you need to reach up there, because him and his buddies, his army, they're all there. And from the Blessed Virgin to all the little angels and archangels and saints, there are quite a few of them up there. They're a little smarter than I am, and I may never get to where they're at, but I hope I get to the right place. But God has to be in your life. All you have to do, if you're not a believer, something is wrong with you, but just look up at the sky. There's a big blue sky. It's full of rain today, but there's a big blue sky. How did that get there? It goes forever. There's no end to it. Well, some little guy, some scientist didn't make that. Only a supreme being like God. So, good Lord, I know I've done some bad things, but man, forgive me today, because I'm reaching out there to talk to you, and you're the most special thing in our life. For all you folks that are thinking about getting married, as Michelle said a while ago, make sure, seek divine intervention, and seek maybe the advice of great friends, a priest, a nun. Don't be afraid, go get married. Then be surprised when you have a kid knocking on the door. But as we stressed earlier, marriage is compromise. You have to respect each other, whether you like it or not, because you two are different. You two are different. Different families, different values. I hope your morals are all alike, and good morals, and I know they are. And I would tell married couples, man, you just can't give up. It's too easy to give up. You can give up right now, walk. Go get two attorneys and go sue each other. Then you got kids hanging around. That's my time to go see my dad. It's my time to go see my mom. That's a tough life. That's a tough life for those children. It's a tough life for you. There are many ways that you can help a broken marriage or one in trouble. You get counseling. You can, again, visit a priest. There's somebody that will help you mend this problem. And work hard at it. Work hard. And look again for divine intervention. Don't forget the big man. And perhaps you'll make it. We've got a high failure rate right now. That doesn't have to be that way. If you will just work at it and learn to accept each other's strengths and weaknesses.